these as objects. Expertise in women is not reflected in the media. These are the constructs. So those constructs were converted into quotes and we had to quote. If I were to apply, I wanted you all to sit and do this. So sometime you can open the newspaper. If I were to use that, they used only for news. They didn't use advertising. I had a separate system on advertising also, but this is only on news. And why news? Because news indicates reality. So advertisement can be construct, advertisement can be paid. So only news we analyze. So we take the front page and we see which are the main news items. So I've got 4 or 5 news items, and then we see which are the images, and then we see in these news items, in how many stories women, I take story 1, story 2, story 3, in how many stories women are in the center. If not in the center, is woman a victim? Or is woman a nobody? And is her photo there? Now if you see, there are 2 news items. One is Manipur's iron, and then the second is the reason for the news. Is it because she is an actor? I mean, she's the core actor, she's the main person in the news? Or is it because she is present as the wife or collaborator of somebody? Now this is very important. She is here as a very important political campaigner. So woman in the political role, woman in the financial role, woman in the expert role. So there is a separate coding for that. Then here is a photograph. Let's see. Why is the woman there? Is she named there? Do you see this? Women in skimpily clad clothes posing for what we call bolt goes nuts over samba. So a samba dancer is presented. Is she named there? No, their names are not there. They are what you call in cheer girls, cheerleaders. So that is objectification. And there are theories on that. Laura Mulvey and all of them have written about how there is what we call as male gaze. Media as a male gaze. Now, the eye of the media is like the male eye. Objectifying the female body as a source of arousal or gratification by viewing. So it was not at all necessary for the first page. It could have had some other photographs. So why this photo? Why not a winner of the medal? So this is the subtle way in which media portrays women in a negative way. And this is the powerful portrayal. Suppose there is Sonia Gandhi or others, then there is a powerful portrayal. Now, do we mean to say that media is erring here? No, it's not. Media is a reflection of the society. News is the reality in some sense, but it is also construction of reality. Rio Olympics is a reality, but this is a construction of reality because the purchase power, even today in society, is in male hands. So the moment they see something that is entertaining, they see female body as a source of entertainment. These are the theories. So how this theory gets validated? So there is a poor representation of media, or negative portrayal of media. Women not as aggregate, thinking, dignified beings, but as disaggregate, objectified beings. So there is a kind of what we call a negative treatment of women by the media. So this is how GMMP project, every 5 years portrayed. In 4 years, the positive portrayal of women, particularly women as newsreaders, young women, men as newsreaders, grey-haired men. So why? Because in women, the physical appearance seems to be valid. They used to say, when Sushma Swaraj speaks, we go to see her, not to listen to her. So these portrayals, you know, so these kinds of discursive practices have been captured. And they said that women's representation did not go, even in terms of content. So if there are 7 stories, there is only 1 story where woman is in center. That means globally, on an average, from 9%, it went up to 12%. The women in center, women as political reporters, women as financial experts, etc. That reflects how our society is. It is not media's fault. But then is the media doing any good by picking up those odd stories and highlighting these women? They do, but only in inner pages, which nobody sees. So this is a, and even in advertisement, you know, the society clearly indicates who has the purchase power. Because a car is advertised and a woman is there near the car. Of course, nowadays women drive the car, but the purchase decision is either made by the husband or the father. So they keep a woman who is in a particular type of clothes as if she is equivalent to that commodity. You know, what's her role there? Is she driving the car? No, she is simply standing. There's a generator. She holds a generator as if she is the powerhouse. So this objectification, negative portrayal, and the way in which it is creating that image, and it adds to the loss of confidence in girls and their self-image, poor self-image, is what is highlighted. I hope that's clear to you. So this is how content analysis was done in communication research. Now from there we moved, content analysis was used in social studies research, literary analysis, film analysis, and now we have come to legal analysis in content analysis. So I have given you examples like Llewellyn, one of the jurisprudents, who is a realist jurist. Llewellyn is also considered neo-naturalist, isn't he? So Llewellyn did study of thousands of motor vehicle accident cases to show how tort law treated accident victims. Similarly, Posner did studies of thousands. Today it is very easy, 10,000 cases also you can study with the database and with Atlas kind of software. So it's a systematic examination of the forms of communication to document patterns. So we saw that, we saw in the court cases. So patent decisions were studied to show how it was there. Primary caretaker standards, I have some examples there which I can circulate. In India, tort of passing off as a practice antithetical to copyright or IPR, recently Delhi High Court Justice Nandra Jog has given decisions. Should we consider if the passing off has happened in a multinational product by counterfeit goods? Earlier they said no because jurisdiction was always national, but now they are telling in the globalizing world you have to look at it as passing off. So how the things are changing, and you should read the discourse of that judgment, which is clearly reflective of judges' progressive and up-to-date capability. In family law, there was a judgment of considering woman to be head of the, entitled to the co-personary property, but she cannot be called karta. So what does it indicate about Supreme Court's ideological leanings, its patriarchal biases? So this is how you can use one argument and you can pick those cases and do the content analysis either on the ideological leanings or on the lack of clarity, or on the way in which scientific methods can be applied and shown how judges' behavioralism happens. Then, Dworkin had written a book called Law's Empire, and in that there is an argument that there is distributive justice and corrective justice. Are these two separate distinctions or are they complementary? If you look at tort law cases, I have a paper where an author has argued that in number of tort law cases, huge compensation. For example, now medical negligence, they are rewarding 6 crores, 2 crores, 3 crores. Is this just distributive justice or is it also corrective justice? Isn't it a very interesting argument? So this author shows how it is also a corrective justice, not just compensatory jurisprudence, but also a kind of penal jurisprudence which is coming in there. Now, procedure to find an answer is called jury matrix. So earlier they used to say jury matrix is about measuring judge's decision. Today we say jury matrix is metering. Metering in the sense of not predictability alone, but applying scientific social sciences methods, qualitative methods to understand judicial mind. So here we see empiricism, speculation, metrics. So now we have jury matrix is applying ICT to judicial decisions, understanding qualitative and quantitative analysis of judicial behavior, mathematical logic. Now, there is also sociometric about gender and class relation, business and legal relation, how judges behave with relation to this. Sociogram, clusters and choices, you know, in a law classroom, how do particular groups of students behave, how is the interaction, these are all jurisprudential. I'll give you one example. Law admission time, how rankings count, how admission increases with the ranking, and is it ranking in the newspaper alone or the social relations this particular elite society has between them. X is a person who says that this college is the first rank, my child is going there, so Y feels competitive and wants to go there, or X encourages Y to go. So social relations also play a subtle role as much as ranking. So that could be a good example for sociometric. Now, in the US, there were many cases where they showed how many judges, they gave a stimulus to the judges by giving a moot court exposition, and then they wanted to see how jury and the judges agreed and disagreed on conviction and acquittal. So how their biases worked was shown by this research. This is also a jury metric research. Then we also have example of defense of insanity. On mock trial, how defense of insanity was construed by different judges and jury. There are also many other examples which is there in my presentation. We don't have so much time. Only one example can be how in shoplifting cases people are tried, you know, the way the judiciary is biased towards the blacks, biased towards the inner city people, people who come from slum equivalent areas, biased towards these children, and then the lengthy judgments which talk about social disintegration, etc. We also have such pontification. Justice Deepak Mishra's recent pontification in one of the cases, I think I have given you, on Samaritanism and how people should behave in case of accident. So this is how we have some implications for India as far as jury metrics is concerned, because discretion is not robotic. Discretion has to be in the context of law. So finally, what we see is it is essential to have collaboration between different actors, different disciplines and different knowledge systems. From that point of view, qualitative case study and qualitative content analysis are as much important as the quantitative approaches are. Although predominantly quantitative approaches have been credited with the more credibility because they have a wider significance, they have wider generalizability. Slowly we are moving into an era where qualitative research is important. I am personally saying that we cannot ignore qualitative research, particularly because if you are doing ethnic studies, if you are doing feminist studies, then it is a qualitative approach which has given better insights. For example, people like Neela would have been forgotten in the number crunching but for case study approach. Would you agree? Yeah. So this is why today's discussion assumes a lot of importance. If there are any specific questions, you may ask. Otherwise, I request you, whether in your dinner time or in the spare time that will be available after lunch, if you can quickly finish your lunch and reflect on those literature which I have given you in the group, and then write your summary as a group. Take 10